Welcome. I appreciate you dealing probably with a couple things this morning, the wind, the rain, the 8 o'clock hour, and potentially some jet lag. So I know these 8 o'clock sessions are a little rough, so really appreciate you being here. I'll try to make this as valuable as I can. What I'm going to talk about today is maybe a different approach or an alternate approach to how you would organize a security program, especially from a staffing perspective and how you have it organized. And the goals, as you see as I talk through this, are really to make the program more diffused throughout the organization, because some of the issues that I found being a CISO at several different companies is a lack of ownership and a lack of engagement with the business and with the other functional areas, because you kind of get this ivory tower syndrome. So we'll talk a bit about that. And the way that I'm going to talk about this is really a journey, sort of a two-part journey. I'm going to go backwards in time a little bit and talk about a few of my experiences with some other companies and where we struggled with ownership and engagement of the security function. And then also talk about sort of an experiment that I'm doing with a lot of slack that my current boss is cutting me to try this at the company that I've been at for about 10 months now. So I use the Great Wall of China to just sort of represent the this empire approach to building a security program. The Great Wall, you know, represents something where there was a ton of time spent building it, a ton of budget, lots of people, centralized management of the construction. So I just thought that created sort of an interesting image for like the security empire approach. It was built starting in 770 BC and then finished in about 1500 during the Ming Dynasty. And I was just wondering if anybody near the front, so I can make sure you don't use Google, has an idea of how long the Great Wall is. Anybody want to guess? 5,000 clicks? It's pretty good. One more guess. Yeah, I was kind of surprised. I was off by an order of magnitude. 13,170.69 miles. I thought it was like 1,200 miles or something like that. I think that's absolutely stunning. It was a survey done in 2012, finally using GPS, and that was the first time that it was accurately assessed. But yeah, again, I'm using that as just sort of that image of what that would look like to build that. It's one of only two man-made objects that can be seen from space. The other one is some of the legacy systems I worked on many years ago. So here's sort of like the setup, the situation is, what if you were putting a security program in place and you had no staff, but you essentially no budget, and you had some ad hoc collection of controls that you were walking into and you needed to build out a security program. So you kind of have to adapt quickly. You might have this empire mindset, like I need to start hiring a bunch of people and get budget and get my arms around this thing and build this central staff. But maybe there's another way of looking at it is maybe you can be an army of one or just an army of a few and try to gather people from broadly around the organization and get them involved in security. And again, this isn't just for a new company or if you're building a program from scratch. A lot of things I'm going to suggest, and you'll see it towards the end, are ideas that you could use to sort of like reassess or rethink how you've put your program together and how you've allocated various functions. So this is going back in time a little bit, what I'll call my journey of discovery. The then end of the slide is about 2000, and now is now. So these are companies with a few interruptions in between when I did consulting, but these are companies where I was the CISO, head of the entire program, or leading one or more business units as the ISO, the information security officer. So the little donut all the way on the left is Carillion. That was an online banking company that was purchased by Fiserv a couple of years ago. And that was 300 people, and amazingly, they were public. It was one of the last companies to go public during the dot-com era. They went public in 99. So it's a fintech company of 300 people. And then, of course, you'll recognize Amazon. I was there when it was a fairly cute, small company. We only had 20,000 people. It's much larger than that now, and we were just rolling out AWS. So that was 2004, 2005. Barclays Bank was an interesting data point. I was based in London. 60,000 people in 60 countries. So that was a sort of a different experience. And then Intuit, you all know about that, about 8,000 people in public. Mercury was a small payment processor that got gobbled up by the next one called Vanta. So they did credit card processing. And then the X at the end is where I am now. That's AvidXchange. We do business-to-business payments. And I just mentioned that to show that there's some diversity in terms of size and footprint and public and private and international versus US. So sort of not an exhaustive set, but some pretty interesting data points. And every one of these I had some issues with in terms of ownership and engagement across the program. So I won't identify which company is which here, but these are the different models I saw. So I mean, a pretty typical one is you have a centralized core team running security, and that's it. And then company B would be a centralized core team, but then they have people on the core team that are called business partners. And so they assign the various business units to be sort of a liaison between the centralized unit and the business units. And then I've seen one where you had a centralized core team and they had business partners, but the business partners actually reported up to and were actually in the business unit themselves. And then I've seen at very large companies where you actually had a corporate security team, and then you actually had satellite entire security teams with duplicative functions like identity and access management and other things actually in the business units. And then I've actually, one of the companies was actually business unit security teams and no centralized function because the business units were so large. But again, what I discovered across all of these was they really struggled in terms of ownership and engagement across the programs. Even these ones with the business partners, if the business partner came from the centralized core team, they were kind of viewed as, oh, that's them. And then even when the business unit partner on model C was actually located in the business unit, there was still a huge gap there. So, you know, the bottom line is it just didn't feel like this was working. And there was a theme in one of the keynotes about business-driven security, and maybe that's those two bullets on the top there. The business doesn't understand security, and security doesn't understand the business when you have these separated organizations. Then you get into finger-pointing and us versus them and the ivory tower syndrome. And again, I think the root underneath all this thing is like, they just say the security guys and gals will take care of it. I don't have to worry about it. And everything is sort of abdicated towards that centralized function. So this was my plan when I came to this this new company, AvidXchange, 10 months ago. And again, I look for these kind of opportunities. I'm much more of a builder than a maintainer. And that's why I've worked at a bunch of different companies. I'm probably one of the main contributors to this thing that says CISOs have a lifespan of 20 to 24 months. I'm part of that problem. But it's by choice. So anyway, here's the plan, and nothing too exotic here, but I'm going to go into each one of these a little bit, and you'll see under the covers that maybe there's a little bit different approach to how you design and deploy the program. And again, be thinking about how this might apply to your program, whether you're building one from scratch or rebuilding one or just sort of rethinking it. I'm kind of curious how many people in the audience are either a CISO or equivalent or maybe one level below. Okay, great. Yeah, I guess that's why you came to the session. Okay, wonderful. So the first one was just identifying the relevant requirements and industry practices. And part of this, I like to use a musical analogy. If you wanted to play a song and you had to invent the musical scale and invent a piano and build it from scratch and then finally play a song, it'd be quite painful and you probably wouldn't bother and maybe it wouldn't sound so good. And I think it's the same thing with security these days. There's good frameworks, models, collections of controls. And I'm not saying you can use them right out of the box, but you certainly don't have to invent this stuff from scratch. So I strongly suggest identifying the relevant requirements and good industry practice and then adopt what makes sense and customize it a little bit to fit your organization. What we did, sort of driven from the top down, the board was very interested in us using the COSA model and the 17 principles there for risk management. And then underneath that, we tucked in ISO 31000 and then 800-30 to provide a risk framework. And I mentioned that because that was some context for the security program. We used that to analyze all the business units and all the functions, including security, to build a risk model and a heat map and a ranked list of the risks that we were facing in each of the major functional areas, including security. From the security side, I'll talk a little bit about some of these in more detail in the next slides, but we're using the critical security controls and the cybersecurity framework. And then underneath that, we tucked in some specific controls that you can see there. The other thing that we did with this program, which has been kind of fun, is we're concurrently building the security and privacy program together. And I've got a talk proposed at another conference called Combine and Conquer, the benefits of building a security and privacy program at the same time. So the next step was to really identify the risks and gaps, and there's been a lot of talks at the conference about debating qualitative versus quantitative risk assessments and formality and stuff, and I'd say this is a real practical and pragmatic approach to it, not super, super structured. But what we did right away is I just pulled out the the 20 critical security controls and just did an assessment against that and also matched it up against an enterprise threat model that I put together. And I did that as a quick diagnostic. And like it says in the last bullet, I just did something really simple. I just said, if that control is missing entirely, it's red. If we got something there that's sort of working, it's yellow. And if it's good and I don't have to worry about it, it's green. Just something really simple. And then we went through and the reds and the yellows ended up on my to-do list of things that we needed to get put in place. And that actually took care of us for probably the first 2 or 3 months. There was plenty of stuff to do there, and that was a good way to get jump started very quickly. And then in parallel, then we started using the cybersecurity framework as a set of security objectives, but there aren't detailed controls associated with it. And then we tucked in selected controls from ISO and NIST and a few other sources underneath as needed. And then you can see we did a little bit of work on privacy as well. So again, just a real practical and pragmatic approach. I guess it was sort of a blend of thinking about it as a risk assessment, but maybe also a maturity assessment. And the reason I get away with saying that this felt a bit like a risk assessment is the CSC is really nice. That CSC control area number 1 is the first one you should go after, and 2 is number 2, and 3 is number 3. So they're actually in order by how effective they are at blunting cyber attacks. So it gives you a nice rank ordered list and approach to closing some of the gaps. So then once we had these gaps identified, we built I built a 3-year roadmap based on those gaps. And it was, again, a risk-based prioritization based on using the CSC and then also the threat model that we had. And then we also looked at building some quick wins because we wanted to start building the brand for the security program because it was a brand new program that we were rolling out. And then also we were pretty pragmatic, again, about packaging things together in terms of the sequence and what we could get potentially get some of the groups to do. And then there were 2 categories that were sort of interesting. There was this book a while back that talked about black swan, something that's very low probability but very high impact. And I think for us as a SaaS-based company and probably for a lot of you, a DDoS attack would fall into that category. The probability that you're gonna get hit with a DDoS attack that's directed specifically at you is probably fairly low, but if it happens, and especially if you're a SaaS company, it's very traumatic. And so we were able to sort of jack that up. You know, if you did the classic thing of multiplying probability times impact, it doesn't come out very high. And we just paid special attention to those to say, yeah, those need to be artificially moved up. And then I've coined the term gnats for these other things that are high probability, low impact, that are just really distracting and annoying. And I would say phishing attacks and end users clicking on links and attachments would fall in that category. And so you might want to jack up the priority on those a little bit just to get those out of the way as well. So this is the part where it gets into trying not to build a centralized security team, but looking for where you can sort of like recruit people throughout the organization and get other functions involved. And so I started looking for synergies. Where are the groups that are doing things that are very similar to needs that I have? And so some pretty obvious ones here. IT already had Splunk up and running, and they had a whole bunch of logs coming to it, and they were using it to monitor our systems from an availability, reliability, and performance perspective. Well, I needed all that same information, that raw information. I just needed to put some different rules on it and correlations and reports on top of what they had already. So, I mean, that was a quick win and easy. I didn't have to build something on top of it. Another example was the HR team already had a learning management system, a SaaS, a third-party SaaS one that they were loading content into, and they have even, you know, gamified it a little bit in terms of like you can get badges and awards for taking classes and stuff. And I wanted to get annual security training in there, get a couple of courses in, and so that was easy. I just had to identify some content for them. They put it in the platform, and they're excited about, you know, being able to drive some more content for users. Maybe one other one. I've always thought that secure software is higher quality because you look at things from a system perspective. And so it's pretty easy to get the software development team on board. And then some of the tools that I was proposing for static and dynamic analysis would be something that they would really like to run because it would force them to look at things from a system perspective and ultimately improve the quality of the software. So it's pretty easy to find synergies, not for everything, but for some critical areas, and that really helped. And then there's actually finding people to do the work. Again, when you're out looking for people, find the ones that have heads on them, ignore the ones that don't have heads. They don't work as well. But again, you're looking at where are those synergies, and then within those areas of synergy, are there some people where the lights are really on about security and you could get them involved? And then there's also thinking about who should actually own and operate these controls. Another quick question, has anybody built a responsibility matrix, or I used a RACI diagram to look at how things are allocated. Yeah, I highly recommend that. It works really well. What you can do is you can take, say, like the CSC, and so down one side of the matrix, you list all the control objectives that you want to achieve, and you can think of those as sort of like titles of processes that you want executed. And then across the top, you don't put people's names, but you put titles. So you have the CISO, the CIO, SVP of development, head of HR, security architect, software developer. You list all these roles, and then you start placing in the intersection, this person is accountable to make sure that control happens. These people are responsible. These people are consulted. These people are informed. You know, so that's the RACI model. And it's really interesting when you lay that out, because then you can look vertically and say, does this person have too much or too little responsibility or accountability or over-involved in the security program? And then you can look horizontally for a particular control and say, do I have too many people involved? Like, do I have one clear person accountable, or are there five people that appear to be accountable? Or can this be executed with two people, or do I have 10 R's for responsibility? So it's a really nice way of sorting out who's doing what, and are any particular people overloaded, or any processes either not being performed or being overloaded with too many people. So a RACI model or some sort of responsibility matrix works really well for that. So this was the result of the team that I put together. So just a little bit more context again. AvidXchange is a business-to-business payment processor, and we do invoice automation, and it's about 900 people. And so there's myself, and then this is the equivalent FTEs that are able to get on board. They're very excited about doing this. In fact, it's quite amazing. There's a lot of people, especially in the technical areas, that think security is really interesting. They just want to know how to get involved, and it gives them another way to contribute and feel like they're making a difference in the company. And so I needed a lot of help in the infrastructure area, so I've got, you know, four FTEs from there, one from desktop, one from DevOps, you see two in software and facilities, and then maybe the equivalent of one FTE across some of these other functional areas. So, I mean, it's roughly 10 people, and there's this number, like maybe between 6 and 12% would be the metric in terms of the size of the security team relative to the IT team. You've heard that a little bit. So this is about at 10%, you know, so we've got 100 people in IT, and I've got this virtual team of about 10 people, so that feels about right, and we're making some really good progress. The other metric that I like to use just as a ballpark idea of the sizing of the security team is 100 to 1 of people on the security team relative to the total employee base. And again, we're fitting in about there. We've got about 10 people here and about 900 across the company. So we seem to be making really good progress with a team of this size, but the really fun thing is none of them report to me. And it's sort of delightful and refreshing not having any direct reports for a change. I haven't done that for a while. And so I'm like in a mentoring relationship with them, and I talk to their bosses, and we just get good, you know, agreement on who's doing what and who's working in what areas. And then also I'd say, geez, not doing performance reviews and all that other stuff, it's freed up 25% of my time. And so I'm getting to work on enterprise risk, I'm working on privacy a bit, sort of trading favors back and forth with some of the other groups, and even playing a security architect role and getting much more involved in product security. So it's probably one of the most fun assignments I've had so far, because I'm getting more broadly involved and not burdened down by actually managing a team. So that was a little bit of a side benefit. Finding budget, you know, that's kind of interesting. So I just sort of collected together, where could I make the business case for these additional controls I needed to put in place? And so there are pain points, you know, from our customers and partners, things that they were struggling with or new features they wanted. Our board members, we got a great board for the company. There were certain hot buttons with them in terms of various controls they had seen at other companies and thought would be appropriate for us. So when a board member asks for something, that's a pretty good business case. In some cases, there were things that were already allocated to some security controls, but they were on the other team, and that was fine. I didn't feel like I had to grab that budget. They could execute it there. It was interesting, the software area, I hit them up towards the end of last year, and they had extra money left over. And yet, you know, you have to watch out that thing about CapEx versus OpEx and stuff, and so sometimes that makes you make a strange decision, but they had a bunch of OpEx left over, so then I ended up getting a SaaS-based static analysis tool instead of bringing one in-house, and it actually worked really well, but they had extra budget for it, and they said, yeah, that would be great, because again, we see the value in doing the static analysis to improve our code, and so they stepped up and paid for it. And then also, you can pull out the compliance hammer if you need to. And then also, it's pretty easy to make the business case for those black swans and the gnats about the things that were going to be almost death for the company if they happen, or things that were just so annoying and we had to get them out of the way. And then it really helps to find a few champions. So I found champions at the technical level, like a lot of those FTEs I had were the people, the individual contributors, where the lights were really on and they really wanted to get more involved in security. So that part was pretty easy. But you also want champions up at the executive level. And so I've got a couple examples here. So I report to the chief risk officer / chief legal officer. And he's been super supportive of the program and selling it with his peers. And the other nice thing about reporting to the CRO has a direct line to the board, and so gets conversations started there and gets me involved in working sessions of the board. So that's been great and then very helpful. So an example of a very active champion at the executive level. At the passive level, it's been kind of interesting. The CIO and myself are peers within the organization, and if you can get that kind of set up, I'd highly recommend that. You really don't want to be tucked in under the CIO if you can avoid it. I'll talk a little bit more about that. But this works really well as a peer relationship, and we just had a conversation about common goals and what we wanted to achieve and how I wanted to do this, and I was going to need to leverage some people on his team, and he was fine with that, but he was also, had a lot of initiatives on his plate and couldn't really get personally involved in it. And he said, let's just stay in touch and I'm going to trust you to run with this and not mess with my team too much. And he said, let's just operate under the principle of no surprises. And so I just worked directly with his first line managers and his teams in like IT desktop and infrastructure, and that's working out fine. And I just give him a heads up and let him know what's going on. So he's sort of a passive champion. He's very supportive, doesn't get in the way at all, and just said, I need to focus on this other stuff, and that's great if you want to grab some of my team. And again, there were synergies there. I helped them make their log management better by the requirements I had, helped them with patch management. I helped them with disaster recovery and a couple other areas that were bothering them anyway. And then our CEO, I'd say, is sort of in transition. He's getting more engaged in risk, more engaged in security, and he's sort of making that transition from being fairly passive and disconnected to being more active and helping set the tone at the top, which is really, really helpful. So execution is really important. There's a book, I can't remember the name of the author, it probably came out 15 or 20 years ago, called Execution, and it talks about that's really easy to make plans and put projects together and stuff, but none of it matters unless you're able to execute. And so these are just some of the tips, in terms of execution, in terms of consistently communicating, what we're doing, why we're doing it, I think was really important. Getting things done by influence. Again, I don't have any direct reports, and so you have to, kind of make that business case and influence others and build relationships. It's great to make others successful, and I'm even happy if I get somebody going in a direction and then they sort of forget that I was involved and they sort of claim a victory there for something that I got started. That's just fine, I don't care. Doing favors and collecting favors, that sounds a little weird, but again, this is all about building relationships, and you don't have to like do it one for one. I'll do this if you do this. You don't have to make that transaction right away. But again, disaster recovery is sort of like a typical IT control, and they didn't have a good disaster recovery program, and I said, I can help with that. Oh.
Execution, the discipline of getting things done. Larry Bossidy, is that the book?
That's the book, yeah. Thank you. Yeah, it's a good one. It's an old one, but sort of a classic. But yeah, you don't have to trade favors like in an immediate transaction. You can do something, help out in a particular area, chip in, and then later you might say, hey, and I could use help with this, and they'll sort of remember that. So it's really all about building relationships. I talked a little bit about we were building a good security brand and then getting some quick wins and just demonstrating value. So pretty standard stuff, but it helps to really focus on execution. So here's some very specific examples. I mentioned on disaster recovery, they wanted some help with it. I found a NIST document that had some really great outlines in terms of sort of like a low, medium, and high level approach to disaster recovery. The medium one looked about right, and so I gave them the outline in the NIST document, and they wrote the plan, and I reviewed it as it was put in place and then was involved in the testing. And so that worked out great. I mean, they took ownership of it, and that's something actually I think they should own. Talked a little bit about application security, so I did some training. My background originally was as a software developer, so I could jump in and do some of the AppSec training myself, and then I helped pick the tools, but they paid for them and got additional training for their team and put them in place, and so that was great, and they're very excited about it. Another good example is like vulnerability management. I put the requirements in place. This is what we need to do, why we need to do it. Here's the SLA. Here's some good references for process around vulnerability management, and then they put that in place with the patch management system, and they own and run it, and I just check in on them and see how it's going. So if you look down both these columns, and again, it sort of fits in with what I was talking about in terms of the size of the team, I'm literally doing 10% of the work, and they're doing 90% of the work, and because of that, there's tremendous ownership and engagement. You know, they can't point to me and say, you know, you're responsible for patching. No, you got it. I mean, you own the thing. And I'll talk a little bit more of this later, but it's good to mention it now, I think. My approach has been to focus very much on my role is to define the what and the why. So this is what needs to happen, and this is why it's important. And then, again, because I have a few extra cycles, I'm helping, let's just generally frame the how. But then I give it to them and say, you figure out how you want to do patch management. You figure out how you want to do the disaster recovery testing and other things, and let them own it by developing it. If I backed up the truck and say, do it exactly this way, step A, B, C, and D, then that ownership and engagement model would break down. And so I'm really giving them a lot of latitude to figure out how to get there. As long as they meet my what and they understand the why, we're good. So the results so far, it's not perfect, but it's working pretty well. Again, really great engagement and enthusiasm across the organization. So I think the engagement and ownership piece is working really well, again, because I'm not over-defining exactly how do they need to do it, and they don't report to me, and they're left in their teams. So that's working really well. We're moving fast. We've gotten a lot in place already. We've been able to expand the scope. I'm actually working part-time on enterprise risk, working on the security program. We're integrating privacy with it, and I'm also getting involved in physical security, so it's nice to have sort of that basket of risk-oriented tasks all in one place and be involved in all of them. And I think we're building a real positive brand. You know, we're not saying no, we're saying, you know, that's interesting, tell me more. We're staying engaged, we're keeping the conversation going, so the security program is viewed as the people that always say no. On the minus side, not always able to find synergy. If I look at the full list of controls, not all of them line up with another organization, so you have to get kind of creative to find a home for some of these things. There's always going to be battles of priority because, you know, these are people that are working in other organizations and have other priorities, so you have to be a pretty good negotiator and, like I say, do some trading back and forth. It's been really hard to track what the investment is. So when senior management says, well, how much are we spending on security, it's a little hard to track it because it's bits and pieces across multiple organizations, and I've been talking to our finance team about how we can create sort of a virtual security budget so I can at least sweep it together and tell how much we're spending in general. Been very interesting talking to partners, mostly a little bit to auditors. So like a potential partner came in reviewing us, and they were going to be a channel reseller for us, and they said, well, tell us about your security team. How many people do you have full-time on security? And I said, one. They said, well, how's that work? And then I showed the other side, well, I've got, you know, 10 FTE, and it's here, here, and here, and they're kind of questioning it and stuff. But then I showed them, and this is what we've accomplished in the past 10 months, and here's some of the benefits. They said, oh, that's pretty cool. Yeah, we like that. And then they were actually whispering to each other about some of the controls we had been able to put in place. And they said, do we have any of that? And I said, no, we don't have that yet. You know, so we kind of won them over. But it's an interesting discussion when you say, oh, yeah, we only have one security person. Being invited to the right meetings, sometimes they forget about you because you're an army of one, so you have to kind of be attentive to make sure that you get in the right forums. It took me 4 or 5 months to get into the weekly architecture review meetings, and I felt like I wanted to get in there early and be able to influence things, but they kept forgetting about me, but I think I'm good now. And then sometimes budgets disappear, so they've got things, and they need to make some adjustments or move things around, and sort of like there's this security thing dangling off the end of their budget, and all of a sudden, no, we need that back. And, well, that's sort of okay, I understand that, but they should tell me about it. I've had budgets that just sort of disappeared at the last minute, so all of a sudden, how come that control, you know, isn't funded or what happened? Oh, we needed it for this, and I said, well, we should have talked about that. But generally, it's working pretty well, and I'm not concerned about doing this. The other thing is that I had a plan B. So let's say on Friday I decide this isn't working, this is really silly, I should stop doing this. On Monday, I could go in and grab some of those people and just pull stuff towards the center. So I can revert back to a traditional model almost instantly, so it wouldn't be that difficult to unwind this. So in terms of application, the greenfield approach is if you're going into a company that doesn't have a formal security program and you're going to build it out for the first time, you basically just go through what I just talked about, through those steps in terms of building out the plan, understanding the requirements, doing the assessments, build a roadmap, look for synergies, and so on. And I think that would work quite well. Again, every company's a little bit different, but I think a lot of these principles would apply. And the other interesting thing that I mentioned is you may not have the opportunity to go in and build a program from scratch. You might be in a program already, and it might be at a much, much larger company. That's the other thing is I'm not sure how well this is going to scale. Our company's gone from 500 people to 900 people just in the 10 months that I've been there, and we'll probably be at 1,200 or more by the end of this year. So, I mean, we're growing quite fast, but so far it seems to be scaling. But, you know, would this work for a 10,000-person company or 100,000-person company? I'm not sure. But I think some of the techniques would be useful. So part of it is sort of thinking about, are there things that I'm doing that I could give away to another team? This isn't really like a core competency for security. It's something that somebody else could just execute. You know, can I get somebody else to do it? And maybe the second bullet is really sort of the same type of thing. Just really think very thoughtfully about what needs to be centralized versus what could be done as well or better by others. I think it's sort of odd on very large security teams where you see them owning and running patch management. It seems like IT should do that. I mean, it definitely should be an IT thing with your requirements and your SLAs, but they should be executing that. So again, you could look at how you've got your team structured and look at what you might be able to push outside of the boundaries of your organization. And again, that probably gets back to that RACI matrix. I mean, just pull out your high-level control objectives, pull out, you know, all the potential people that could be involved and lay it out as it is today, and then start looking at moving those things around and say, I don't know why we're doing this. IT should own it. HR should own it. Legal should own it. So I think there's things that you could push out and, again, get those benefits of better ownership and engagement. And I think it would also apply to outsourcing. Again, we're looking at outsourcing very selectively. We do some third-party monitoring of our IDS and other things like that. And so that's another potential source is, again, you may not have to own it. If it's a commodity type service, you might be able to get a third party to do it. And again, I'm relying heavily on what I call the what, why, and how recipe. The role of the central security team should be defined. This is what we need to accomplish in terms of security. This is why it's important. And then just generally framing up, and we'd like to do it in this general form or fashion, but then let the other team define the how in detail. So a couple of critical success factors. I had an advantage. The manager I'm working for, I worked for two companies ago, so we had an established relationship and a level of trust there. And then it probably ties into the last bullet as well. You know, we both know that if this experiment doesn't work entirely, we can go with plan B and selectively pull functions back to the center if needed. So I don't think there's a huge risk here. You have to either create or leverage the security culture, so it really helps to build that security brand and get more people engaged. I've had the opportunity to talk at our town hall meetings about risk and sit in on various team meetings and just sort of build that brand and make security interesting and compelling to the rest of the organization. This is probably one of my little rants is trying to not report to the CIO or the head of IT. I mean, I like to think I'm doing information security, I'm solving a business problem, and so why should I be in IT? And so I at this point in my career, I refuse to do that. And it just happens to be that maybe 80% of the controls or solutions happen to be technically oriented, but I'm not doing network security, I'm not doing platform security, I'm protecting information. That's, you know, and you do the other stuff in service to protecting information. So I really like that. That relationship, and also I think you have the right discussions in terms of if you can be a peer, the CISO, with the CIO, you have the right good discussions and the right tension going back and forth, and you're not trumped by them trying to reduce budget, reduce costs, or being overly focused on attributes that they have to achieve, and there's a ton of synergy there, so I really like that relationship. I've done that out of all those companies, I've done that three times where I've been the peer of the CIO or equivalent, and it's a really healthy and great relationship, much better than being underneath. So if you can make that happen, it's fun. Execution is important, trading favors, and again, having a plan B lets you back out of this a little bit if you get a little too aggressive. So again, your journey will be different. If it's your first time being a CISO, I don't know if I'd recommend doing this. It's a little sporty. But interesting, and like I say, I'm having more fun than any other CISO role I've had so far. Jury is out regarding scalability. Again, I'm doing this at a smaller, fast-growth company. It's working out well for us, and I think some of the benefits, even if I start pulling stuff to the center slowly as we get bigger, I think I'm establishing that level of a very positive security brand and a high level of engagement and a high level of ownership that's going to continue. You know, so we're building that positive brand, and I don't think it'll go away. So if someday we're a 10,000 person company, I think we'll look back and say it was good to at least start this way and set that really positive tone of security being a partner. I like one of the presentations, I think it was on Tuesday, the gentleman was talking about doing security with the organization, not to the organization. And I think this is a good model of that, is we're working with them. It's not security being inflicted on the organization, but it's just being systemic. It's part of the organization, and that's making a big difference. And again, learning as we go here, you just got to be willing to fail fast, learn and adapt. So I've been doing some pivoting and moving around where I've tried things and that didn't work quite right, or I really should put this control over there. And so just being pretty agile makes a big difference. That's the end, and I'm happy to take some questions, but you might wonder why that picture there is there. I couldn't resist putting that up. That's a 1977 Mini, and so that's what I do outside of work to maintain my sanity. Just to let you know how low tech it is, it has four fuses. That's it. So very simple, you can open the hood and actually understand what's there. But the fun thing about it is, I've been working on that car since 2003, and a couple summers ago, I drove it 250 miles to a car show, parked it, dusted it off, and took first place in the foreign category, beating Ferraris, Porsches, Jaguars. There were a bunch of stunning foreign cars there, and this one took first place. So people appreciated the quality and uniqueness of the car. And so I kind of think about that as maybe another analogy to my approach here, is that I think you can have a small, feisty security program and still be pretty successful. So thank you very much. And then just real quick, and feel free to ping me if you've got follow-on questions or some of this stuff looks interesting. I just put a couple quick samples in here. Here's links to some of the guidance that I was using for the program. And again, this is all online. This is an example of that real simple high-level threat model I was using to help set some initial priorities. Nothing too exotic, but again, happy to share that if anybody's interested. This is how we were doing the assessments, you know, so basically a security maturity model. So you could either do the red, yellow, and green thing, or you could do a 0 to 5 maturity scale. So that was really quick and easy, just doing a spreadsheet to get things started. This is the roadmap, just tracking things by category and item and a description, and then where did that requirement come from, what's the priority, when do I want it done, and who should own it, and what the status is. So that was real quick and easy as far as a tracker. And then I think anybody that's a CISO, you're getting a lot of your work done by influence. Even if you have a large centralized team, you still have to work with the entire business and influence other people. And I found these four books were just amazing. There's three on influence, and then this one by Jeffrey Pfeiffer on power, why some people have it and others don't. These are just absolutely fascinating books. And I think, you know, as a CISO, you really need to pay attention to the people side of things. And these have been amazing books that have really helped me a lot. Yeah, so I just wanted to point those out. So again, those are in the PDF. So happy to take questions if you have any. Uh-oh, did this make any sense? Go ahead, please. Can you use the microphone?
Oh.
Yeah.
This thing on. All right. So great approach. I've been there, and it's I've done a hybrid of it. My question is the untouchables, right? So the groups that you're told don't touch, don't bother, engineering teams, things like that. Mm. Other than building relationships and, you know, the standard, you know, build a bridge concept. Any other techniques that you've used that you found successful to get through to those groups that you've been told not to mess with because
really
they're critical
to
the
mess with them.
Absolutely. Mm. Yeah, you haven't had that.
I haven't run into that, not at this company at all. I'm trying to think in the past, yeah, not really. I don't think I was ever told anybody was off limits. Now, once I talked to the business unit of the function, you got a lot of pushback, but I tried to at least get the conversation to neutral. So they may not be a fertile ground for giving me any budget or any people or being able to integrate with them, but I at least wanted to get them to neutral that they know that security is important and know what we're doing and why we're doing it. And so it might be a dead end in terms of, well, that's not an area where I'm going to be able to diffuse functions into it, but I would never just back away and say that's a black hole. I got to build some sort of relationship there. So I think it's just, you know, it's conversations and working with the leader of that business unit and try to build a good peer relationship. Yeah. That's a tough one. If somebody just dictates that that's off limits for security, that doesn't sound right. Security should be everywhere. Okay, well, thanks again. And again, my email's there. Feel free to follow up. Appreciate it.